A very good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis brought to you by Shankar IAS Academy for the day 1st of December 2021. So I've chosen 5 articles for today, and we have 2 articles in the polity perspective, wherein in one article we are going to discuss about an upcoming bill called as Judges Bill, and then in another article we are going to discuss about citizenship. And then we have a report on the suicides that is happening in India, and then we also have an article on the Indian bison, which is covered in the environment perspective. And then we also have a discussion on vaccine hesitancy, which is a social topic. So this is what we are going to see in today's discussion, or in the next 30 to 40 minutes. So with this idea, now let's move on to the first news article. Now look at this news article. It is about a new bill that was introduced in the Lok Sabha. And this bill deals with the pension for judges. And the name of the bill is High Court and Supreme Court Judges, Salaries and Conditions of Service Amendment Bill 2021. And this bill is also called as the Judges Bill. Okay, so in this discussion, we will see on what this bill is about. And we will also see the various provisions of this bill. So the syllabus for this article is given here. You can make a note of it. See, this bill aims to amend 2 acts which are related to the salaries and the pensions of judges of the Supreme and the High Court. So these 2 acts are the High Court Judges Salaries and Conditions of Service Act of 1954 and the Supreme Court Judges Salaries and Conditions of Service Act 1958. So, the basic purpose or the objective of this bill is to clarify about when these judges, that is the judges of the Supreme and High Court, are entitled to an additional quantum of pension or an additional quantum of family pension on attaining a certain age. So, now let us understand what is this additional quantum of pension or additional quantum of family pension actually means. So, we all know that pension is a periodic payment which is made to public servants who have completed their service. Not all the public servants are entitled to the same pension rules. In the sense, public servants in different organs of the government, they will be having separate pension rules. So, just understand that this pension rules is not the same for everybody. It changes with organ to organ of the government. So, this pension rules, it provides various kinds of pension based on the nature of retirement, the duration of service, and also based on the mode of retirement under statutory rules. And this pension, it includes the gratuity or the other sums of payment which are payable by way of death or retirement benefits. And always remember, the pension amount is not the same always. It will be modified by the parliament from time to time. So when you take this 1958 act, you remember I told you 2 act before, right? So one act is this 1958 act, which is called as the Supreme Court Judges Salaries and Conditions of Service Act. So according to this act, Supreme Court judges will be receiving pension on their retirement only if they fulfill 2 conditions. So the first condition is they should attain the age of 65 years. And the second condition is their retirement should be a result of the ill health of the judge. That is, the judge should have retired based on some health problems, and the ill health condition, that is the deteriorating health condition or the bad health condition, should have been medically certified. So only if they fulfill these 2 conditions, the Supreme Court judges will be able to receive their pension. So as per this act, the pension that is provided to the Chief Justice of India should not exceed ₹16,18,000 per annum. Remember, per annum, that is for 1 year alone. So this 16,18,000 per annum is a criteria for the Chief Justice of India. When you take the Supreme Court judges, their pension should not exceed ₹15 lakhs per annum. Now here you should note that this 16,80,000 for the Chief Justice of India and the 15 lakhs for the Supreme Court judges is called the basic pension. Okay, so it is called the basic pension. So now we saw the pension details about the Supreme Court. So now we'll move on to the pension details for the High Court judges. See, in the case of pension for the High Court judges, 3 conditions need to be fulfilled. The first is that the judge should have completed 12 years of services. Secondly, the judge should have attained the age of 62 years. So the third condition is the judge's retirement should be a result of the ill health of this judge, just like how we saw in the case of the Supreme Court judge. And as per this act, that is the Act of 1954, which is the High Court Judges Salaries and Conditions of Services Act of 1954, the basic pension which is provided to the Chief Justice of High Courts shall not exceed 15 lakhs per annum. Again, this is per annum only. And for the High Court judges, it shall not exceed rupees 13 lakh and 15,000. Okay, so by now I think you have a understanding about the pension of judges, the conditions that they need to fulfill in order to avail this pension, and also the laws that govern the pension of the High Court and the Supreme Court judges. So now let's see what is this family pension which we saw earlier. See, family pension is the pension which is provided to the family in case of death of the pensioner. Now here the word pensioner refers to the judge who is receiving the pension or who is about to receive the pension. Now here the pensioner could have died after retirement, or he could have died while he was in service. So this pension is provided as a percentage of the last salary which was received by the pensioner. So for the Supreme Court and for the High Court judges, the family pension amount is fixed at 30% of the salary to about 50% of the salary. And this again is not the same for all. It varies according to different situations. Now coming to the next concept, which is the additional quantum of pension. See, this additional pension is available to the old pensioners when they attain a certain old age. See, basically this pension is applicable only for those who attain 80 years of age. So you may have a question like, why this additional pension amount is provided? So the main reason behind it is that the needs of old pensioners increase with their age. That is, as people grow older, they will have more health issues. And this leads to more expenses, especially medical and health expenses. So this is the reason why this additional pension amount is provided, because the needs of old pensioners will be increasing with their age, especially the health expenses will increase. So to take care of such expenses, this additional quantum of pension is provided. And more importantly, it is provided in addition to the basic pension or family pension. Remember, it is provided in addition to the basic pension or family pension. We already saw what is the criteria for the basic pension and also for the family pension. So now this additional pension will be given in addition to those amount. And note that this additional amount will be shown separately in the pension payment order. Now, in the case of retired judges of High Courts and Supreme Court, the additional amount is sanctioned for different age slabs. Like, it is sanctioned on completing the age of 80 years, and then 85 years, 90 years, 95 years, and up to 100 years. And this is as per Section 16B of the Act, which is related to the Supreme Court judges, and Section 17B of the Act, which is related to the High Court judges. And I have given below the different age slabs that is being followed for your reference, so you can just have a look at it. Now coming to this bill, see, our bill here is regarding this additional pension only. It clarifies from when these people can actually claim this amount. See, in the year 2016, a writ petition was filed by a retired High Court judge by name Virendra Dutt Gyani. So he asked to consider the additional quantum of pension to be made available from the first day of his 80th year. He came up with this issue because generally what happened was, after the completion of 80th year only, the additional amount was calculated. So it is because of this reason only he came with the writ petition and asked to consider this additional quantum amount from the first day of his 80th year. And this particular request was agreed by the Guwahati High Court in the year 2018, and the same was also upheld by the Supreme Court. So after the judgment, the first slab under the additional pension would be available to a retired judge right from the first day of his 80th year, that is immediately after completing 79 years of age. Now this judgment is what is being incorporated by the bill to the respective acts. And the bill here is also has an explanation saying that the entitlement for additional quantum of pension or family pension shall be from the first day of the month of age mentioned in the first slab, which is nothing but 80 years of age. So I think you would have understand what this bill is about and what are the major provisions related to the pensions of judges and what was the recent writ petition that was filed and what was its implications also. So with these ideas in mind, come let's move on to the next article. I hope you all are aware of the Omicron. Wherever we turn, we hear people talking about it. And even this article here is something related to it. It talks about the recent decisions that were taken in the state of Kerala in the light of the new virus variant Omicron. So the news here is that the Kerala government has decided not to give free COVID-19 treatment for those people who are not cooperating with the state's prevention and containment activities. And it is also strictly said that the government would not be obliged to treat the unvaccinated individuals who become COVID positive. So it indirectly says that only if people are vaccinated and if they happen to get affected by the disease after vaccination, they'll be treated by the government. On other cases, no treatment will be provided by the government. See, we know that still a lot of people are actually battling with vaccine hesitancies and because of which they are yet to get vaccinated. And of course, there may be various reasons for people to be hesitant. So in order to break this chain, the Kerala government has come up with stringent laws. For example, those who are not vaccinated due to reasons like serious diseases or allergies, they are asked to produce a medical certificate which is issued by a government doctor. And likewise, teachers who are unvaccinated because of any medical issues, they are also asked to produce a medical certificate which is issued by a government doctor. And for others, they are given the liberty to choose between taking up the vaccine or to be prepared to do the RT-PCR test every week and to submit its result. And this same conditions is said to be applicable even to those unvaccinated individuals who are working in offices and other public places. And the local body representatives are given the responsibility to find those people who are yet to get vaccinated in their particular locality. So now in this backdrop, let's briefly see about vaccine hesitancy, which is dealt in today's article. See, the primary purpose of vaccination is to protect the individuals against severe infections. So taking vaccines on a large scale will actually lead to herd immunity, and this herd immunity will prevent the prevailing of the disease, the outbreaks and pandemics. But the major obstacle in achieving this herd immunity is vaccine hesitancy. See, vaccine hesitancy refers to the delay in acceptance or the kind of refusal which people show towards vaccines despite the availability of vaccine services. See, this tendency of vaccine hesitancy is not just prone to India, but then this is something which can be spotted throughout the entire world. See, the major concern with this vaccine hesitancy is that it will lead to slower vaccination, and slower vaccination in turn will lead to the spread of infection, and it also poses greater chances of mutations as well as the emergence of new variants. So now let's quickly see some major factors that can cause or influence vaccine hesitancy. See, the lack of awareness regarding the extent of vaccine benefits is one major cause, and there is also a fear which is created by the inaccurate and also the false informations which is being circulated in social media. So these false information and these inaccurate information creates a kind of fear among the people when it comes to vaccine, and this fear is further aggravated by the spread of informations which are associating these vaccines with unrelated disease, and this will eventually lead to the lack of confidence in getting vaccinated among the ordinary people. And apart from this, the cost of vaccines can also be a reason for people to stay away. But then this cannot be a valid one because we all know that the government has been arranging a lot of camps where they are providing free vaccines. So even if people cannot afford vaccines, they can actually go to these places and they can get vaccinated. It is one reason, but then it is not really a valid one at most instances. And adding to this, a certain religious propaganda can also contribute to this hesitance which is showed towards vaccines. Now, say for example, vaccines contain microbes, chemicals and animal derived products, which is actually forbidden by certain religious laws. So for those people who follow such religious laws, it may be quite difficult to accept vaccination. Adding to this, digital divide, especially in online services like Cowin platform, leads to inconvenience in accessing vaccines. But however, we cannot always judge that it is only vaccine hesitancy which acts as the major hurdle for the safe and speedy vaccination. Of course, it has got a great role to play. But then this is not the only reason, because apart from this, even factors like supply deficit, federal distribution of vaccines, and then vaccine procurement rates, digital divide also play a role in affecting the safe and speedy vaccination. So now let's quickly see some measures that can be adopted to overcome this vaccine hesitancy. So first of all, the spread of misinformation in social media should be monitored and curbed, and only science-based and especially authentic information should be allowed to be circulated. And then awareness on the benefits of getting vaccinated should be spread on a wider scale. And in this regard, help can be sought from local authorities, cultural leaders, local artists and also influencers. They can be directed to ideate and innovate awareness through music, murals, graffiti, dance and drama using local languages and dialects in such a way that it reaches even the grassroots people. And even the ASHA workers and the auxiliary nurse midwives can be used to dispel vaccine knowledge. And then separate helplines can be brought in this regard to provide information on vaccine related pre and post counseling to individuals to address their queries related to vaccine registration. And they can also be directed to indulge in effective follow-ups with the people who get vaccinated. And even missed call campaigns can be launched in this regard. See, trust building has got a potential role to play in this regard. So on that line, the manufacturer can actually provide honest information about the side effects, and also it can provide a reassurance on a robust vaccine safety system so that the people can have a clarity on what it is and the issues around it. So once they have this kind of clarity, it will actually help them to overcome the fear and to be confident enough to move forward and take up the vaccines. So these are some important points which can be used in your mains examinations. So kindly make a note of it without fail. You can just note down the important points alone and you can use it for your last minute revision. And this is one of the major reasons why I chose this article. So I think by now you have a fair understanding about vaccine hesitancy, like what it is and what are its benefits. And we also saw what is actually preventing people from getting vaccinated, the various reasons contributing towards it. And then we concluded the article with some measures that can be adopted to overcome this hurdle and to pave way for a more safe and speedy vaccination process. So now let's move on to the next news discussion. Now look at this news article. This news article talks about the renouncing of Indian citizenship by Indians. So the news here is that a greater number of Indians have renounced their citizenship in the past 5 years. But however, the reason for renunciation is not known. So here we should remember that India stands second to China when it comes to the high net worth individuals leaving the country. So just remember this fact. So in this discussion, we are going to see the constitutional provisions which are related to citizenship. And then we will also see the various ways in which a person can acquire Indian citizenship. And then we will end the article by talking about the different kinds of laws of citizenship in our country. See, as you know, citizens are full members of the Indian state, and being full members, they owe allegiance to Indian state. So, the citizen of a country generally enjoys all the civil and political rights, and all these civil and political rights are provided to the Indian citizens under the Indian Constitution, and it is also provided to them through a statute, Citizenship Act of 1955. Okay, so just remember, we Indian citizens enjoy all civil and political rights, and these rights are bestowed to us through our Indian Constitution and through the Citizenship Act of 1955. So now let us see the important provisions in our Indian Constitution that deals with citizenship. So whenever you learn about citizenship, you always have in mind that Article 5 to Article 11 of our Constitution will be dealing with citizenship. See, these articles identify the persons who became citizens of India at its commencement, that is on January 26, 1950. So remember, these articles, they generally don't deal with the problems which are related to the acquisition or with the laws of citizenship. And also, always have in mind that the term citizen is not mentioned in the Constitution of India. See, this is actually an important fact for prelims. So whenever someone asks you whether the term citizen is mentioned in the Constitution of India, you should be bold enough and you should just blindly say, no, it is not mentioned in our Indian Constitution. See, Article 11 of our Indian Constitution enables the regulation of Indian citizenship even through the laws enacted by the Parliament. So for this purpose, the Citizenship Act of 1955 was enacted, and this Citizenship Act provides for the acquisition and the laws of Indian citizenship. Now here also you need to remember one fact, that this particular act, that is the Citizenship Act of 1955, has been amended 9 times. So just remember, it has been amended 9 times. So now let us see the way in which one can acquire citizenship. See, actually there are 5 ways which are prescribed in the act using which one can acquire Indian citizenship. So the first one is acquiring citizenship by birth. Now according to this way, a person who is born on or a person who is born after the 3rd of December 2004 is a citizen of India. But then this provision comes with a condition that at least one of the parents of the child is an Indian and the other is not an illegal migrant. Okay, now coming to the second way in acquiring citizenship. See, the second way of acquiring citizenship is the citizenship by descent. Now, this citizenship by descent is for those persons who are born outside India on or before the 3rd of December 2004. So, such persons can be an Indian citizenship by descent if either of her or his parents was a citizen by birth. Now, next is acquiring citizenship by registration. Now, see, this is applicable for various categories of persons, such as it is applicable for person of Indian origin, which is a resident of India for 7 years before applying for citizenship. And it is also applicable for those persons who are married to an Indian citizen and has been a resident of India for 7 years before applying. And then the fourth way is acquiring citizenship by naturalization. Now, this is for a person who fulfills the qualifications in the 3rd schedule to the Act. So, some of the qualifications for acquiring citizenship by naturalization are that the person should be a citizen of any country, or she or he should have resided in India for 12 months before applying for citizenship, or she or he should have been in the service of a government in India prior to applying for citizenship. So if they are able to fulfill these qualifications, then they can very well acquire citizenship by naturalization. Now coming to the fifth or the last way, which is citizenship by incorporation of territory. That is, any person becomes a citizen if any territory becomes a part of India and the same is notified by the central government. So these are the 5 ways in which the Indian citizen can be acquired. So I will just repeat the 5 ways. First is citizenship by birth. Second is citizenship by descent. Third, it is citizenship by registration. Fourth, it is citizenship by naturalization. And finally, it is citizenship by incorporation of territory. Okay, so now we will move on to the last part, which is the kinds or the ways which leads to the laws of citizenship. So the first in this list is renunciation. See, any Indian citizen can renounce their citizenship through a declaration in a prescribed manner. So if anyone renounces their citizenship, then even their minor child will stop to be a citizen of India. But then, however, the child can regain Indian citizenship later if he or she wishes. So importantly, even today's news is regarding this issue only, that many Indian citizens have renounced their citizenship. But however, the reason for Indian citizens renouncing their citizenship is not known. And here we should note that recently the government has eased the process of renunciation of citizenship. And after this eased process, it just takes a maximum of 60 days or approximately 2 months for the renunciation process. Now, the second way in which a person can lose his or her citizenship is by termination. That is, an individual's citizenship is terminated when she or he acquires a foreign citizenship knowingly or voluntarily. Okay, and the last kind in losing citizenship is by deprivation. Now, under this, the central government terminates the citizenship of a person for any one or more of these reasons. And these reasons include obtaining citizenship by fraud, disloyal to Indian constitution, unlawful trading or communication with the enemy during war, if imprisoned in any country for 2 years within 5 years after registration or naturalization, or if resident is out of India for 7 years continuously. So these were the ways of acquiring citizenship, and these three, that is renunciation, termination and deprivation, are the ways in which a person can lose his or her citizenship. Here you should also remember that there are certain fundamental rights which are enjoyed only by the citizens of our country, like the right to equality, the right to freedom of speech and expression, etc. So with this, let us wind up this discussion and we will move on to see what the next news article has got to tell us. Now, let us take up this news article. So this news article here talks about a video that has been circulated. And in this video, a man was found to attack an injured Indian gaur. Now, based on this context, we will see about the Indian gaur, which is in limelight here. So, the scientific name of Indian gaur is Bos gaurus, and it is commonly referred to as the gaur or the Indian bison. So, this species is the largest living bovine, and it belongs to the group of wild oxen, which includes the Asiatic buffalo, the African buffalo, and also the bison. Note that there are three subspecies of gaur. The first one is Bos gaurus, which is found in India, Nepal and Bhutan. The second one is Bos gaurus reedi, that occurs in Indochina region and also in the region of Myanmar, etc. And then the third one is the Bos gaurus hubaki, which is found in Thailand and Malaysia. Now, let us see some specific characteristics about this Indian gaur. See, the gaur bulls are larger than the cows, and they generally weigh between 600 to 1000 kilogram, and they have a very wide shoulder. So these species, they have horns and they have a shoulder hump, which is found to be more pronounced among the males than females. So these animals are known to have a maximum longevity of about 30 years, and they are social animals who usually live in herds. Also, they are diurnal species in the sense they'll be active during day, and they inhabit a wide variety of habitats ranging from the tropical wet bamboo forest, the tropical moist deciduous forest, the tropical dry deciduous forest, the Shola forest in the Western Ghats, etc. And they are also an important prey species for the endangered flagship species, tiger. Now, on talking about their distribution, see, this Indian gaur or the Indian bison is confined to the Oriental biogeographic region. So you may wonder, what is this Oriental biogeographical region? See, this is a region that extends eastward from India. So it basically includes Indian mainland and much of Southeast Asia. So that being said, this Indian bison is found in Nepal, India, Bhutan, Cambodia, China, Peninsula Malaysia, Myanmar, Thailand and Vietnam, etc. And within India, this gaur is isolated into three disjunct regions, and they are the southwestern India, the central India and the northeastern India. So now let us move on to say about the various factors that threaten this species' existence. So the first is poaching. These species are poached for consumption, crop protection, for medicinal use or as a part of trophy hunting. And then another threat faced by them is the habitat loss and also the fragmentation, particularly in the northeast India habitat, where the degradation is brought about by the shifting cultivation. And other than this, the conversion of forest areas to agricultural use or commercial plantations is also another serious threat. See, this threat of habitat loss and also the fragmentation is not just limited to Indian gaur, but to most of the animals which are in the endangered and the critically endangered list. And it is because of these factors like habitat loss and fragmentation only, we happen to come across a lot of human-animal conflict as well. Okay, so just have this in mind. Now, thirdly, the species is also vulnerable to all the diseases that infect cattle. Say, for example, like rinderpest, foot and mouth disease, anthrax and hemorrhagic fever have been found to be responsible for the mortality of gaur. And apart from this, they are also threatened by predators, especially when they are little calf. So these threats led to the extinction of species in many protected areas of India, and it is said to have disappeared from the Bandhavgarh Tiger Reserve and the Sanjay National Park of Madhya Pradesh, and even from the Thattakad Wildlife Sanctuary of Kerala and the Kanger Valley National Park in Chhattisgarh. So due to these reasons, the Indian gaur is characterized as vulnerable in the IUCN Red List of threatened species. I repeat, it is categorized as vulnerable in the IUCN Red List of threatened species, and it is also listed in Schedule 1 of the Indian Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. And then it is also included in Appendix 1 of CITES, which is also known as the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species of Wild Fauna and Flora. So these are the important points about the Indian bison, which would be helpful for you in your exam perspective. So now let us move on to the next news discussion. Now for my next news discussion, I have chosen this data point article. See, recently the accidental deaths and suicide in India report for the year 2020 was released. And this report covered various dimensions relating to deaths due to accidents and suicide. And this data point article also deals with the same. So now in this context, let us see about the report and its important findings. So come, let us get into our discussion. The syllabus covered by this article is highlighted below for your reference. See, the ADSI, which stands for the Accidental Deaths and Suicides in India, is a statistical data which records the accidental deaths and suicides in our country. See, this report is released annually, that is, it is released once in every year by the National Crime Records Bureau. So the basic objective behind this report is to provide exhaustive or holistic data on accidental deaths and suicides that happen in India. Because having a holistic knowledge or understanding on this issue will actually help our policy makers to form or to frame better policies for preventing the unfortunate loss of life. So, in order to release or to frame this report, the data is collected from the District Crime Records Bureau, by the State's Crime Records Bureau, and then these data are sent to NCRB, the National Crime Records Bureau, at the end of the year, and these data are later compiled and released as the ADSI report annually. Now remember, the first edition of this particular report was published in the year 1967, and the most recent edition is this one, which is the ADSI 2020. See, we all know that suicide is a way in which a person puts an end to his or her own life in a very unfortunate way. So each suicide is a personal tragedy that steals an individual's life too soon, and that which has got the potential to create a long-term impact on the lives of the victim's family members, friends and communities. Do you believe every year more than 1 lakh people commit suicide in our country? See, such premature deaths are not only traumatic to the family and also to the people around, but it also results in the loss of productive man years. So this loss of productive man years actually influences the economic development of our country, because most of the people who have lost their life would have contributed towards the economic development of our country, and they would have been more of an asset than a liability. So when viewed in that angle, suicides actually influence the economic development of our country in a negative way, and many of such victims have been economically active. They have been supporting their families and they were contributors to the overall economic progress of India. So it becomes really important to identify the root cause of these issues and to formulate suitable policies in order to prevent such unfortunate loss of life in the days ahead. See, there are various causes of suicides, or various reasons can induce a person in committing suicide. So some popular problems that instigates people to commit suicide are professional or career problems, the sense of isolation, abuse, and then violence. Even family problems has got a great role to play here. And apart from this, mental disorders and then addiction to alcohol, financial loss, or even chronic pain can actually put a person into such situation. Now, this NCRB, or the National Crime Records Bureau, they collect data on suicides from the police recorded suicide cases, and the rate of suicides will be calculated using projected population for the non-census years, whereas for the census year 2011, the calculation was done based on the population in the census 2011 report. Now let's see the major findings of this ADSI report 2020. See, in 2020, a total of 1,53,052 people were reported to have committed suicides in our country. Now this estimation is said to be the highest number of suicide deaths in the past 53 years, because this is the first time in over 50 years that the number of suicide deaths has crossed 1.5 lakh. Now look at this table. As you can see here, there is a 10% increase in the number of deaths in the year 2020 when compared to that of the 2019 levels. And as shown here, 1.29 lakh deaths were recorded in 2017, and this is said to be the lowest estimation in the decade, that is between the years 2010 and 2020. Also know that 2020 has marked the highest annual suicidal death rate since the year 1982, and the rate of suicides rose by 8.7% in 2020 over 2019. Now look at this graph. As you can see here, the year-on-year growth of death by suicide has actually crossed the 10% mark on only 4 occasions between the years 1968 and 2020, and 2020 is the 4th highest since 1968, which has crossed the 10% mark, and it is also the highest since 1982. Now let's look at these data in the profession-wise dimension. So when you take the profession-wise dimension, in 2020 alone, a major part of suicide has been committed by the daily wage earners category. They alone constitute to about 24.6% of suicide deaths, and it is the highest among other professions. And in the year 2020 alone, 37,666 daily wage earners died by suicide. And this number is 15.7% higher than that which was recorded in the year 2019. And even though the students' deaths in 2020 is just 8.2%, even this is said to be higher when compared to that of the 2019 report, because this year the students' deaths have jumped by 21.2%, and this is said to be the highest jump among all professions. Now coming to the state-wise estimation of deaths, see, states like Chhattisgarh, Kerala and Tamil Nadu recorded the highest deaths by suicide per lakh people. So when you see in terms of percentage share between the states, you can find that Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu and Madhya Pradesh are found to be the highest. So these are some important facts that were highlighted in the report as well as in the data point which we took for discussion today. So you can actually use these statistics to support your argument or your points in your mains exam. So make sure to jot down the trends of suicide deaths in the last 10 years, because these data may be useful to you in some way or the other. So with this, we are done with the article discussion for today. So as you all know, our next segment is the practice question discussion. Now look at this question. Consider the following statements. A judge of Supreme Court and High Court is eligible for pension if he or she has completed 12 years of service and attained the age of 65 years. And statement 2, the judges of Supreme Court and High Court are eligible for additional quantum of pension or family pension on attaining 70 years of age. So we need to find the right statement here. So when you take the first statement, it is not correct, because the 12 years service condition is only for the High Court judges and the 65 years criterion is for the Supreme Court judges, because for the High Court judges it is 62 years. Okay, so this statement is wrong. Now coming to the second statement, see, this statement is again incorrect, because the judges of Supreme Court and High Court are eligible for additional quantum of pension or family pension on attaining 80 years of age and not 70 years of age. Okay, so this statement is incorrect as well. So since both the statements are wrong, the correct answer here would be option D, which is neither 1 nor 2. Now look at this prelims practice question. Consider the following statements. Statement 1, originally the Citizenship Act of 1955 also provided for Commonwealth citizenship. Statement 2, the provision for Commonwealth citizenship was repealed by the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2005. So we need to find the correct statement here. So when you take the first statement, this statement is actually correct, because the Citizenship Act of 1955 did actually provided for the Commonwealth citizenship, according to which every person who is a citizenship of India also acquires the Commonwealth citizenship. Okay, so the first statement is right here. Now coming to the second statement, see, actually this statement is incorrect, because it is true that this provision for Commonwealth citizenship was repealed through an amendment of this act, but then this was not repealed by the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2005, but rather it was repealed by the Citizenship Amendment of 2003. So it is not 2005 amendment, it is 2003 amendment. So therefore this statement is incorrect. So only the first statement is right here. So from this you obviously know that the correct answer here is option A, that is one only. Now look at this question on Indian bison. It asks, which of the following are the threats facing Gaur, also known as Indian bison? And they have given four options. One is poaching for meat. Second, it is trophy hunting. Then third comes shifting cultivation. And then it is rinderpest and foot and mouth disease. So if you are carefully paid attention to my discussion, then you will be knowing that all the four options which are given here are right. So therefore, the correct answer here is option D, that is 1, 2, 3 and 4. See, I just wanted to give you a very brief description about this Rinderpest, which is given as the fourth option here. See, Rinderpest is an infectious disease in cattle, which is caused by a virus called paramyxovirus. So this disease is generally known as cattle plague or contagious bovine typhus, and it is characterized by fever, dysentery, and also by the inflammation of mucous membranes. So, since all the statements given here are right, the correct answer is option D, that is 1, 2, 3 and 4. So, the list of mains questions are here. So, please write your answer, take this initiative seriously and post your answers in the comment section. So, with this, let us wind up the discussion for today. And if my video was helpful for you, don't hesitate to like, comment and share, and do subscribe to our Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates regarding UPSC Civil Services preparation. Thank you.